We'll move on from learning about bioreactors' mode of action to talk about how well bioreactors work, how much they cost, and barriers and opportunities for this conservation drainage practice. I'm sure you're wondering right now, how well do bioreactors actually work? I monitored 10 bioreactors in Illinois for a combined 34 total site years. These included bioreactors designed by the NRCS and bioreactors we designed for research purposes. And across those site years, we removed, on average, 22% of the nitrate that would have otherwise gone downstream. This nitrate removal effectiveness at the edge of the field, the y-axis here, includes water that bypassed the water untreated. If you look at just water that was routed through these bioreactors, our effectiveness for the treated water averages in the 50s. On average, 51% of the nitrate that went into the bioreactor was removed. But remember, we don't treat all of the water in a given year, which is why that first graph is lower. And if you want to look at this more on a mass basis or a loss basis, we were removing on average very consistently about 4 pounds of nitrogen per acre per year by these 10 bioreactors. State nutrient strategies developed in the upper Mississippi River Basin states have assigned a range of effectiveness values for bioreactors and other practices. Iowa uses a value of 43% for bioreactors, Illinois recommends 25%, and Minnesota recommends a lower value of 13%, which makes sense because it's colder in Minnesota and bioreactors don't work as well when it's cold, but there's also been less research on full-size bioreactors in Minnesota. Also keep in mind these different values may be in part because bioreactors are a relatively new technology. We've been studying things like wetlands and terraces for decades, whereas bioreactors as well as saturated buffers are much newer with most research activity within the last 10 years. So what have bioreactors cost to build? I'm showing the total construction cost of 5 bioreactors built in Illinois. These were all designed and built according to the NRCS conservation practice standard, and you see the costs range from $6,100 to a little over $14,000. That averages around $10,000 per bioreactor. And on a drained area basis, that averages about $450 to $500 per acre treated. I also want to point out that these drainage areas are relatively small, in my opinion. We should be targeting bioreactors on larger drainage areas, like 50 acres or more. Because remember, the larger the drainage area, the more mass of nitrate, the more pounds or kilograms of nitrate that will come from that drainage area. And our data do show that as drainage area increases, the mass of nitrate that is removed also tends to increase. Obviously, your bioreactor size and the cost also increase with larger drainage area, which our data also show. Bioreactors are thought to be relatively cost efficient in terms of dollars per pound of nitrate removed. In the early days, about 10 years ago, bioreactors were coming in at about $1 per pound of nitrate removed. Most published literature has reported a range of about $2 to $15 per kilogram of nitrate removed, which is equivalent to about $1 to $7 per pound of nitrate removed. My most current data shows slightly less cost efficiency for bioreactors. The median here is $33 per kilogram of N removed, or about $15 per pound of nitrogen. Some of the sites that I monitored just had really low nitrogen removal, which made them not very cost efficient, but these are the real data. One of the reasons for this, in my opinion, is because we're targeting drainage areas that are too small, and so we're really limited on the actual pounds of nitrogen that we could actually be removing. Opinions are free, though. Nevertheless, bioreactors are still considered a pretty targeted and pretty cost-effective practice for nitrate loss in tile drainage. Digging into more specifics of the cost of bioreactor construction, across 8 bioreactors in Illinois, the largest proportion of the capital cost was the contractor labor as well as the wood chips. Together, those two costs make up about 75% of the total cost. We'll come back to this, but first I think that this bioreactor performance and cost information that we've been discussing eventually begs the question, how many bioreactors are we really talking about in Illinois, for example? Our Illinois nutrient loss reduction strategy presents a scenario calling for bioreactors on 50% of tile-drained acres. So how many would that be? Let's do some example calculations. We can estimate that there are just under about 10 million tiled acres in Illinois. Multiply that by 50% that we want the bioreactors on gives us total acres that need a bioreactor, not just a few acres. Assuming we design bioreactors to treat a maximum of 80 acres means we need more than about 60,000 individual bioreactors in Illinois to meet that one scenario goal. That's a little unlikely. Hate to say it, but that's a little unlikely. So let's go back to some of the cost breakdown to discuss ways that we could work towards achieving this. Starting with contractor labor, there might be some opportunities to improve and offer more trainings, practical trainings, for contractors to help reduce their costs, since this is the single largest cost for bioreactor installation. However, contractor costs need to be balanced with profitability for contractors so that they can justify their involvement. The second bullet represents an opportunity or idea to reduce wood chip costs. I want to jump back to this graph for a minute and point out that this red point at the bottom here was a bioreactor that the farmer constructed himself for free. He didn't pay himself, and he used chipped storm debris that he had gotten for free from a local municipality. I wouldn't say that this storm debris was ideal based on our wood chip specifications that we'll talk about in the next video, but the overall cost of less than $3,000 is a really important point. I like the idea that farmers could possibly build bioreactors themselves, and I think more research on some of these free or low-cost bioreactor fill media is definitely merited from the standpoint of scaling bioreactor adoption and keeping costs low. Moving to the engineering costs, full disclosure, the cost numbers I'm showing you for my bioreactors in Illinois do not include the cost of engineering. The bioreactors that were included in this cost graph were either designed by myself or my team as a part of our research, or by the NRCS, so taxpayers really paid for those designs. Thus, the engineering costs were internalized for all of those designs. However, as we really start to scale bioreactor adoption, remember the 60,000 bioreactors that we calculated a second ago? These engineering costs will not be immaterial. It's unlikely that the NRCS has the personnel capacity to design bioreactors at that scale. No disrespect meant, that's just the reality. And so, unfortunately, also, one-off bioreactor designs on individual tile outlets are generally not cost-effective to be bid on by private engineering firms. Design work by private firms could add 50% to 100% of the installation cost. So we're talking about as much as doubling that total installation cost if you have to pay for engineering design. That's a non-starter for me. So one option is to rethink how we even design bioreactors. Is it possible to have a modular plug-and-play style of bioreactor? These pictures are obviously septic tanks, but what if we did something modular like this, where there were minimal design costs and the farmer could even install it themselves? It's a very interesting idea. This last bullet, the batch and build approach, is a newer concept to help scale and accelerate adoption of both bioreactors and saturated buffers in Iowa. This is where groups of bioreactor and saturated buffer installations can be batched into a local watershed scale or county type scale area to leverage an economy of scale. One fiscal agent, that's a key term, one fiscal agent coordinates the bid process for the engineering firms and the drainage contractors. This helps make the bidding process more palatable for both engineering firms and contractors, because you know you're going to be designing or building not just one, but maybe as many as 50 practices within a given time frame. This really streamlines the process for the landowner too. You don't have to go into the NRCS office, compile an equip package, find a contractor, et cetera, et cetera. It's all done together for you. It's a smart approach to conservation that's gaining ground in Iowa here in 2023 as I record this video. If you're interested, I'll include a link for this podcast at the end of the video where this program is more fully described. Let's continue to talk about opportunities for bioreactors. And to me, one of the biggest opportunities is that as an edge of field practice, a bioreactor provides a benefit in that it does not require a producer to change what they're doing in the field. After all, what's happening in the field is that producer's bottom line. We're transitioning into this era where society not only demands food, but also demands it to be produced in a way that's good for our water and good for our air. Edge of field practices provide somewhat of a safety net, in my opinion, to allow a landowner to contribute to this societal cause while still being comfortable with their production system. After we implement conservation practices in our watersheds, it will take time for improved water quality to be consistently measured in downstream waters, like the Gulf of Mexico. This lag time means that until we actually see an improvement in downstream water quality, we need to track and report what conservation practices we're doing to better demonstrate that we are making progress towards goals. Edge of field practices are easy to verify and track for reporting purposes because they're structural and have a permanency in place, at least for their design life. Edge of field practices that are engineered offer flexibility because custom designs can be created for each situation. And to me, this is an important opportunity. Lastly, I'll point out the opportunities for collaboration that bioreactors present, both international collaboration and collaboration across sectors. For example, farmers in Queensland, Australia, growing sugarcane are trying woodchip bioreactors to reduce nutrient pollution impacting the Great Barrier Reef. Bioreactors are being assessed for aquaculture farms in Denmark. Bioreactors are being tried in New Zealand for drainage from dairy pastures. Bioreactors can be used for treatment of nitrate from point sources like greenhouse facilities, and also for tertiary treatment of municipal wastewater. The future is really bright for this technology. I'll see you next time.